Okay, the next item of business, a debate on motion 11803 in the name of Emma Roddick on the impact of UK government asylum policy and legislation in Scotland. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Emma Roddick to speak to and move the motion. Minister, around 13 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name. We recognise that, unfortunately, asylum policy is currently reserved to the UK Parliament under the Scotland Act. The Scottish Government has been clear through our Building a New Scotland migration paper that in an independent Scotland, we would take a very different approach to asylum and migration, building a new system based on treating people with dignity and respect and upholding our international and moral obligations. But the purpose of holding this debate today is to discuss and highlight the impact that UK government asylum decisions have had here in Scotland and on national and local government as well as third sector ability to support asylum seekers who live here. As the Scottish Refugee Council is fond of saying, powers are reserved, people are not. And in Scotland, we are determined to support everyone who lives here to integrate into and contribute to our communities. We want to respect and protect the human rights of everyone and provide opportunity and equality, regardless of anyone's background. Supporting asylum seekers and treating them fairly when they engage with devolved services is our responsibility, and we have made it our business. But it is undeniable that UK government decisions, and I'll come on to speak to a few recent ones in particular, impact on our ability to do that successfully and to the best of our ability. Earlier today, I spoke, as I regularly do, with representatives from the Scottish Refugee Council and COSLA about exactly this issue. And I want to lay out some of the most concerning impacts that they've shared of UK government decisions on their ability to do the work that they do. We discussed how seriously councils take their responsibilities to unaccompanied asylum-seeking children and how lack of adequate funding to support this work is impacting how well it can be done. I've also heard how lack of funding to support councils to work with newly recognised refugees is forcing people into destitution and putting councils in the difficult position of dealing with sudden spikes in homelessness presentations. The UK government claimed on the 2nd of January that the legacy asylum backlog had been cleared, and it published data suggesting that in the 4 weeks from 10th of November to 17th of December, last year, there were 20,481 initial asylum decisions made. Now, that is more than in the whole year of 2021. And we know that thousands of cases remain unresolved. And I've heard through the Women's Integration Network in Glasgow from people who have been seeking asylum for over a decade. Women who have not left Scotland since before Facebook launched, holding babies who were born here, but who have no idea when they might be able to be allowed to stay and work to support those babies, or what they might do if that application is refused. Now, we've long called for improved speed and quality of decisions, but the approach to doing this without support or coordination with local councils has left people destitute and homeless. It means receiving a positive decision can be as stressful as receiving a negative one. Suddenly, the very little support that you have disappears, with a very short move-on period, and for many, the only option is to present as homeless to the local authority. Without communication and financial support from the UK government, councils are struggling to do right by those who've been given positive decisions but have nowhere to turn and nowhere to live. The new Minister of State for Legal Migration and the Border confirmed to me on the 3rd of January that the UK government will not provide any additional funding as a result of the increase in asylum support cessations. In this incredibly difficult situation, local authorities across Scotland are engaging with asylum dispersal, with now nearly half of local authorities in Scotland taking part. There are, of course, housing pressures in many of these council areas. However, that does not prevent Scotland from doing its part in continuing to support refugees and people seeking asylum. What it does do is increase the importance of genuine engagement from the UK government with local authorities on asylum dispersal and related matters to give them a fighting chance of supporting people to avoid homelessness and destitution, genuine engagement which is sadly still missing. Now, similar difficulties arise in third sector support, and I want to acknowledge, as always, the vital work that the third sector does in Scotland to support asylum seekers. It is one of the privileges of this role to be able to work so closely with the Scottish Refugee Council, who are, of course, one of our partners, along with COSLA, in New Scots. Our New Scots approach has now been in place for a decade, and it's in the process of being refreshed, with a new strategy expected to be published at the end of March and to be followed by a delivery plan in the summer. Throughout its life, it's always held the core principle of supporting integration from day one of arrival in Scotland. But it cannot directly address issues which are out with the scope of the Scottish Government, Scottish local authorities and other Scottish organisations. UK Government decisions, therefore, have a significant impact on what can be done to support people seeking asylum and communities in Scotland, even in devolved areas. And we are limited in that aim of supporting integration from day one. In a debate last year, I highlighted a comment from the Global Refugee Forum, where I'd been told that there are asylum seekers living in Scotland who have never heard of Scotland and are unaware which country they're in. Now, if someone is unaware that they're in Scotland, it becomes near impossible for us and for the third sector to communicate to them their rights and Scotland-specific services that are available to them. All the while, the UK government is seeking to restrict the right of people to seek asylum in the UK at all through the Illegal Migration Act. And the third sector, like the Scottish Government, is keen to mitigate, wherever possible, the worst impacts of the Act. But UK Government plans to implement it remain unclear, making it very challenging for all of us to consider the best way to do that. This, of course, follows the Nationality and Borders Act of 2022. Two clauses in the bill triggered a need for legislative consent, which the Scottish Parliament voted to withhold. The UK Government then made no changes in response to the views of and the lack of consent from the Scottish Parliament. Then we got the Rwanda Bill, the second piece of asylum legislation introduced last year that the Home Secretary could not guarantee would be compatible with the European Convention on Human Rights, leading to flippant comments from some politicians down south about whether we should get rid of ECHR responsibilities altogether. The Scottish Government has opposed plans to relocate people to Rwanda to have protection claims considered there since those plans were announced in April 2022, because it undermines the 1951 Refugee Convention. The decision of the Supreme Court in November to reject the government appeal was very important, but we've been disappointed with the UK government's reaction since in doubling down and introducing emergency legislation to try and force this through anyway. The UK is, of course, a founding signatory of the 1951 UN Convention on Refugees, which is hard to picture now in comparison to this UK government and its constant attacks on the rights of people to seek safety and sanctuary here. We have a duty to uphold that convention, not constantly try to find ways out of it. But it doesn't look like we're anywhere near having a UK government that will accept those facts. And files recently released by the National Archives in London outlined consideration by the former Labour government to accommodate asylum seekers in Mull. And the First Minister was absolutely right to note... Certainly, yes.
Paul O'Kane.
The Minister will want to, I'm sure, note that that suggestion which came from civil servants was not taken forward by a UK Labour government and, in fact, was dismissed. And I think, for the accuracy of the debate, she'll want to acknowledge that.
Minister.
Certainly be pleasantly surprised if next Labour government comes in and makes big changes compared to the UK government that we have right now. But I have to say, based on the rhetoric coming out from the current Labour and Conservative campaign, it does seem to me that the First Minister was right to describe an apparent race to the bottom on immigration policies. And no UK government in recent memory has attempted to move towards a humane and dignified asylum system which promotes integration and actually welcomes people. And the broader rights and freedoms of asylum seekers is also a concern. People seeking asylum who would be otherwise destitute can apply to the Home Office for accommodation and financial support while they wait for a decision. Asylum accommodation is provided on a no-choice basis. And as of 2 days ago, we understand that asylum support rates have been reduced to £8.86 per week for people in catered accommodation. That's around £1.25 a day. New maximisation policies also increase risk and misery by requiring unrelated adults to share hotel rooms in contingency asylum accommodation. Not only that, but there was a complete lack of engagement with Scottish local authorities prior to procurement of hotels for this use within their areas, or later for the decision to bring in the new maximisation policy. People seeking asylum are also, of course, restricted from working unless granted permission by the Home Office, and we are prevented in most cases from supporting asylum seekers due to the application of no recourse to public funds. We owe those people better. Their human rights are not being realised on £1.25 a day of financial support, the inability to go out to work to earn for themselves, and that terrifying uncertainty over their future casting gloom on every single thought that they have. Every person living in Scotland who does not have the right to work or enough money to support themselves is also a huge wasted potential. These are all people who could be making positive change for others, could be running popular businesses, could be supporting our public services and contributing to our local economies. And that's why we're developing a proposal for an asylum right to work pilot in Scotland, which analysis has told us could add an estimated £30 million a year to the Scottish economy and help fill vital but currently vacant roles. I also discussed with the Scottish Refugee Council the impact of divisive rhetoric and inhuman language and the importance of showing political leadership in promoting the positive impact that a fair and sensible approach to asylum and migration would have on Scotland. Together with refugees, recently commissioned research which showed 80% of people in the UK want to see that approach, one which is fair, compassionate and well managed. The current mess does not work for anyone, whether it's asylum seekers, employers, business or government, anyone. People want to see others treated with fairness, and they want those living in Scotland to be able to engage with their local communities and employment opportunities. And that's exactly what the Fair Begins Here campaign is calling for. So I'd like to take the opportunity to welcome that campaign and direct all those with an interest towards it. I know that many of my constituents and probably constituents of colleagues across the chamber want to do their bit to make positive change for asylum seekers in Scotland. And I hope that others will join in sharing the spirit of that campaign and calling on the UK government to deliver. I also know, having met a few myself, that there are incredible success stories of where integration has worked in Scotland, and that MSPs across the country will be aware of these too. So please talk about that, and please highlight the benefits of migration and supporting others. Let's shift the rhetoric to a more positive place, because Scotland should be a good neighbour, a contributor to global priorities. We should be encouraging migration to Scotland and enthusiastically welcoming those who want to live here and contribute. We cannot do that if we are seen as a country which sees incomers as worth less than others. Pieces of legislation like the Illegal Migration Act, as well as commentary that suggests human rights are optional or even unwanted, do no favours to the UK's international reputation, and Scotland is at real risk of being dragged right down with them. I'm committed to continuing to raise issues with reserved asylum decisions, pushing the UK government to make sensible changes, like allowing the right to work, and continuing partnership working with COSLA and the Scottish Refugee Council. However, I want to be clear that this job, whoever tries to carry it out, will continue to be extremely difficult, and our future is uncertain while we remain in the United Kingdom and beholden to UK governments with increasingly concerning ideas about how to treat asylum seekers and refugees. The only way to make sure that we meet our moral and legal obligations to the people seeking sanctuary here, the only way to direct resources and spending to where it is needed, and the only way that Scotland will have an asylum and migration system that actually works for our needs, is independence. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Calling the next speaker, can I gently remind those who haven't yet pressed their request to speak buttons and are looking to participate in the debate to do so now or as soon as possible. And I call on Miles Briggs to speak to and move amendment 118.03.1. Mr Briggs, around 9 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The United Kingdom has a proud history of supporting refugees. Since 2015, as a country, we've offered a home to over 500,000 men, women and children seeking safety, including those from Hong Kong, Syria, Afghanistan, and most recently those fleeing President Putin's illegal attack on Ukraine. To put that in context, that is the equivalent to the population of Edinburgh being resettled in the UK. All of us agree that it is right that we respond appropriately to the plight of individuals and families escaping violent, authoritarian, dictatorial regimes that systematically persecute and even execute their own people. I recently, as part of the Scottish Parliament's cross-party group on Bangladesh, visited the Rohingya refugee camp at Cox's Bazaar in Bangladesh, and I refer members to my register of interest. And I think I speak for all MSPs who are on that trip. when I say it was deeply humbling experience and demonstrated not only the vulnerable humanitarian situation, but also the unstable situation that continues to face the Rohingya people and the ongoing civil war in Myanmar, which is deeply concerning. And since 2017, has seen an estimated 1.4 million Rohingya flee into the neighbouring Bangladesh. And I would pay tribute to the government of Bangladesh's response to that crisis, and indeed the global response and support that has been provided. And I also very much welcome the UK government's leading role in that. Since 2017, the UK government has provided £370 million to support Rohingya refugees and host communities in Bangladesh, and nearly £30 million to support Rohingya and other Muslim minorities in the Myanmar's Rakhine state. Deputy Presiding Officer, I believe the UK government is a force of good in the world and a global leader in supporting and helping refugees. Although SNP and Green ministers do not wish to acknowledge this and have tried to make this debate about independence, it is in fact one we should be proud of. And I agree with the Minister that the backlog and the time taken to decide if a person can remain in the UK is not acceptable. And it's vital that agencies process asylum claims quickly and efficiently for the good of all concerned. It is indeed welcome that steps in recent months have been taken by the UK government to help address this situation and resolve back... Yes, I will.
Minister.
Particularly because I know that the member has a keen interest in housing and homelessness issues, would he back our calls to the UK government to extend the move-on period for positive decisions to 56 days rather than the current 14?
Miles Briggs,
I'm coming on to that later in my speech. I think, and certainly the briefings which have been provided for this debate make a very important case for that, and I think it's something colleagues across the UK should look at, how we can improve that situation and create more safeguards is something I'm more than happy to assist to try to see resolutions. And with regards to the Minister's comments with the 4,500 complex cases which have been highlighted, these need additional checks and investigations, we know that. And these are hard cases, often with asylum seekers presenting as children, where age verification has to take place with those with serious medical issues, or those with suspected past convictions needing to be checked. So I think there is more complexity to this situation as well. If I can get some more time back, yes.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Miles Briggs for taking my intervention. Would he recognise that the values employed by UK Borders Agency in things like age verification wouldn't necessarily subscribe to the values we hold in this chamber, and that it is often coming from an atmosphere of disbelief, that people are often required to evidence past trauma and even evidence of torture before their asylum claims are assessed?
Miles Briggs.
So, I think some of the changing nature of how verification can take place has also seen reforms recently by UK government. That should be welcome. Documentation is always one of the key aspects of this. If you arrive in a country without a passport, then verifying who you are, what age you are, takes time. And I think even the member would accept that our systems have to be able to verify people, especially around past criminal convictions, where criminality would bar asylum in this country. I think I haven't heard any members say that that shouldn't be the case in this debate so far. But the UK government has been directly helping people who are from regions of conflict and instability. The best way to help the most vulnerable people is for them to come to this country through safe and legal routes. That will stop what can only be described, and this hasn't been touched upon by the Minister, the evil criminal gangs which are preying on vulnerable people, including children. That's where we need policy solutions. And I have never heard SNP ministers say what they would be doing to stop those who are bringing criminal gangs and preying on these. I want to make some progress because I've already taken two, and I'm not sure the Deputy Presiding Officer will give me that much time back. Uncontrolled immigration and unchecked illegal immigration can have very serious consequences. We've seen that in the English Channel and the loss of life, unacceptable loss of life. That is why it's right to find solutions to stop people putting their lives at risk by crossing the English Channel in small boats and come to this country illegally. We must ensure that those coming to this country seeking asylum do through legal routes. This significant increase in dangerous journeys across the Channel is something we in Scotland do not directly witness. But working to stop people traffickers and those who are putting people's lives in such great danger should be a priority for us too in this place. Those in need of protection should claim asylum in the first safe country they reach rather than risking their life and paying people smugglers to take them on illegal and dangerous journeys. Yeah. We all want to see an effective asylum system. And it's also wrong to suggest, I believe, that the UK government does not take the welfare of those in our asylum system extremely seriously. At every stage of the process, the UK government seeks to ensure that the needs and vulnerabilities of asylum seekers are identified and shared with local authorities and health partners. That is why, as a country, the UK government has spent £3.7 billion in this fiscal year alone to support refugees. And the Minister should also maybe reflect on the decisions taken by the Scottish Government to cut council budgets and what impact this will have on housing in Scotland as well. We know both our main cities declaring housing emergencies already. There's always been a need to review policies and look at how support can be provided, working closely with the NHS, local authorities and non-governmental organisations to ensure that people can access healthcare and the vital support that they need, and especially around mental health support. That's something I've had in my own casework since I was elected, and we know just the challenge of mental health services for all of us in this country, not least those who are seeking asylum. Asylum seekers have access to health and social care services from the point of their arrival in the UK, and all asylum seekers, regardless of the type of accommodation they are in, have the same access to free NHS services as any British citizen and other permanent resident. It is just getting access and getting those services which is often the problem. The Home Office also operates safeguarding hubs to support vulnerable individuals into quickly accessing healthcare services and information. I'd also like to pay tribute to the third sector, who are doing so much good work in this area. A number of organisations have made important points in their briefings ahead of today's debate, including the British Red Cross and the call for the Scottish Government to better monitor, inspect and regulate the use of housing in Scotland by empowering local authorities and regulatory agencies, such as the Scottish Housing Regulator. And that's something I think we should look at, and we'd be open on these benches to considering that actively as part of the new housing bill, which the government are still to bring forward. Presiding Officer, to conclude, delivering a modern and responsive asylum immigration system for people seeking asylum is not easy, but in an ever-changing world and with growing pressures of the global movement of people, it must be based on people coming through safe and legal routes. We understand the pressures faced on our asylum system, but I hope the Scottish Government and UK Government will actually commit to work together this year to put in place solutions, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr Briggs. Just to advise the Chamber, there is a bit of time in hand across the course of this afternoon, so members taking interventions will certainly get that time back. I now call on Paul O'Kane to speak to and move Amendment 11803.2. Mr O'Kane, around about 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. We gather in a new year, but in many ways I don't think much has changed in terms of the issues we are debating and the approaches being taken to asylum policy and legislation. We've had no less than 5 debates prior to Christmas on this subject, looking at issues ranging from the Illegal Migration Bill, now the Act, to the provision of free bus travel for asylum seekers, the important work of the Equality, Human Rights and Civil Justice Inquiry into the experience of asylum seekers and refugees, to the Scottish Government's latest independence paper on migration. I have to say that I believe these debates have been most beneficial when we have found consensus in terms of our approach, but also discussed how we can use the powers of this Parliament to make a real difference to the lives of refugees and asylum seekers here in Scotland, and to continue to support them. And I would, of course, point to the important recommendations of the committee report in that regard. Of course, on each of these occasions and in many other debates last year, we on these benches have condemned the shambolic and uncaring asylum system operated by the UK Conservative government. And on each of these occasions, we on these benches have reiterated the need for a more humane approach to asylum processing and migration, and to reiterate that migrants, refugees and asylum seekers should feel safe and welcome when fleeing persecution, war and violence. And also, each time we have come to the Chamber to debate these issues, we on these benches have asked the Scottish Government what more it can do to support asylum seekers, address the issues outlined in the Equalities report that I referenced, and respond indeed to the challenges posed by the Illegal Migration Act, which I have already referenced. Presiding Officer, I spoke in opening that it may be a new year, but we have not seen a new approach from the UK Government. They continue to press ahead with the Rwanda scheme, despite it being ruled illegal, as we've heard already, and next week we will see it again being rushed through the House of Commons in its new form. Thuella Braverman may have gone as Home Secretary, but still the pernicious approach persists, with Tory MPs now battling it out to see how the plan can be made even more deplorable. And we have a Prime Minister who now privately thinks that it doesn't actually work, but clearly sees culture wars as his last throw of the dice this year. To quote Yvette Cooper in the House of Commons yesterday, in the end, the only deterrence that appears the Prime Minister actually believes in is deterring his backbenchers from getting rid of him. It's weak, and yet the taxpayer is paying the price. It's a totally farcical situation. A Prime Minister who doesn't think it's a deterrent, a Home Secretary who thinks it's batshit, a former Home Secretary who says it doesn't work, an Immigration Minister who says it doesn't do the job, and everyone else who thinks it is a complete sham. Labour has been clear that we would scrap the Rwanda scheme. It is unethical, unworkable, and extortionate. And we need real policy changes to deal with the challenges that we face, not the gimmicks that the Conservatives continue to pursue. And that is why Labour has set out a five-point plan to fix the asylum system, to form cross-border policing units, to crack down on the smuggler gangs who are trafficking people and putting people into unthinkable situations, to clear the backlog that we've already heard about this afternoon, to end the long waits, the expensive use of hotels, to reform legal routes for refugees coming to this country, to negotiate new returns and family reunion agreement with France and other European countries, and to tackle humanitarian crises at source and better support refugees in their own regions. So I think it is simply disingenuous. I'll just finish this point and then I will. So I think it is simply disingenuous to say that there would be no change with the Labour government, and I'll give way.
Donald Cameron.
Can I just ask, does he support the... Would a future Labour government, in the hypothetical situation that arises, would a future Labour government process applications abroad?
Paul O'Kane, and can I also advise members, even if they are quoting other members, that there are still requirements in terms of the language used in this chamber? Paul O'Kane.
I'm very sorry, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I will blame Yvette Cooper rather than myself, but I take the point well made and I apologise to any colleagues who may have found that offensive. To answer Donald Cameron's point directly, because I think there was some commentary on this over the Christmas period, what is quite clear is that the processing of asylum claims in third countries can happen and already happens in a number of scenarios. So, for example, Ukraine and Hong Kong, people can have their... case considered while they are in those countries. So I think we can look at certainly where we can process people's asylum claims when they are in a safe country. So again, for example, if someone has arrived in France and has their asylum claim considered there, then I think that is certainly something worth looking at. What the Labour Party is absolutely clear about is not offshoring asylum claims to third countries like Rwanda and standing against that proposal that comes still from this Conservative government. As I said at the beginning of my contribution, I do want to also focus on the approach we should take in this Parliament. And I have raised over several debates my concerns that we do have to do more in order to ensure our local councils and communities can support asylum seekers when they live in those communities. And indeed, I think also to ensure that we are taking the action we can against the Conservatives' Illegal Migration Act and policies. And indeed, I've raised with the Minister a number of times the importance of a mitigation plan and the work that has been called for by the Scottish Refugee Council in that regard. And I know that in our last exchange, the Minister did commit to ongoing work with the Scottish Refugee Council. I think they are now quite clear that commencement is definitely upon us in terms of 2024. So I would be keen just to hear again more from the Minister, if she can, or Christina McKelvey in summing up. Or certainly I'll take an intervention at this stage.
Minister.
I would absolutely love to give more information, but as the member will know, we're still in the position where we're desperately asking the UK government to give us more information. As soon as we know the plans for implementation, then we will know what we can do to mitigate the worst impacts.
Paul O'Kane.
That said, there are a number of issues where the Scottish Refugee Council have highlighted what action could be prepared for and could be planned for, and I do think it is incumbent upon us and upon the government to ensure that those preparations are well advanced, because we do know where some of the most serious impacts are going to come from. Time, of course, is limited in the chamber, so as I said, I do think it is productive that we try and focus on some of the work that we can do. We've heard from the Minister about the new Scots and ending destitution strategies and the refreshment of that in March. I think it is important that we continue to scrutinise that work and ensure that the voices of lived experience and indeed of those third sector organisations that are so crucially important are heard in the formulation of those strategies and ensure that we push them forward to ensure that we are well supporting asylum seekers and migrants here in Scotland. Our amendment has outlined, I think, the challenges that do exist in terms of local authority budgets and the provision that local authority can make, not at least in terms of the challenges that exist in housing. The promise of 110,000 affordable houses by 2031 is unlikely to ever be met by this government after they cut the affordable housing supply budgets by 30% in real terms this year. So I think it is crucial that the decisions that are taken in that regard are going to have a knock-on impact on all of our communities, including those who are new Scots and those who are seeking refuge and asylum. And I think it's not only that, but I think when you speak to people in local authorities, they are really struggling in terms of keeping services on the road, ensuring that populations are being well looked after. So I really do think it is crucial that we get to the nub of sustainable local authority funding, ensuring that local authorities have the resources that they need to support all of their citizens. So, in concluding, Presiding Officer, I think it is important that we ensure that we continue to call out this UK Conservative government for their failed policies and for their callous approach. It is clear that change will come with a UK Labour government in terms of a different approach to our asylum system and ensuring that we treat people with dignity. But for our part here in Scotland, we need to ensure that we are using all the powers of this place in order to support asylum seekers and to support our local communities. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr O'Kane. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton, around 6 minutes. Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the Government bringing to this motion to Parliament's attention this afternoon. And as Paul O'Kane says, here we are again. I think it is vitally important that this chamber comes together as often as possible to reassert our collective view on the moves by the UK Conservative Government in terms of policy on this area. As I have done so many times in debates like this, I have lent into the words of another. I will do so again in the words of the author Dina Nayeri, who was just a child when she was forced to flee from Iran. She said, "It is the obligation of every person born in a safer room to open the door when someone in danger knocks." The obligation, her words. I last spoke about our obligation to those seeking safe harbour on our shores when the Chamber debated the Equalities and Human Rights Committee report on asylum seekers in Scotland. That has been referenced several times this afternoon, and rightly so. I was heartened by the debate we had on that occasion. It did foster a largely consensual tone. Sadly, quite the opposite was true last month in the House of Commons when the ruling Conservative Party, among them all six Scottish Conservative MPs, including Douglas Ross, and the Conservatives voted to pass the second reading of the government's Rwanda plan. A plan, Presiding Officer, which would see plane loads of vulnerable people who have sought refuge and asylum here to see them deported 4,000 miles away to a country that the UK Supreme Court has deemed to be unsafe for them. We hear a lot about moral panic in our society, Presiding Officer, but I want to see a moral panic about that. Instead of backing down and seeing the error of his ways, Rishi Sunak is pressing on with ill-fated attempts to pass a bill that states that Rwanda is a safe country, a policy that it now appears he actually disagreed with when he was UK Chancellor. It's a bill that prevents judges from ruling otherwise and that lays aside key aspects of our human rights legislation. That, in turn, would bypass the Human Rights Act of 1998 entirely, undermine the independence of our courts and indeed damage our reputation internationally if there is much of a reputation left. And they've yet to reach the amendment phase, where extreme factions of the Conservative Party will undoubtedly attempt to make the bill even more odious. We've badly forgotten the obligation that Dina Nayeri writes of. Douglas Ross and his colleagues have forgotten that this country is made up of those who came here from our shores, and that our very proudest moments in our nation's history have been defined by offering shelter to those in need, like the Kinder transport during the Second World War, or Biafra. Instead, we have asylum seekers living on barges that look more like prisons. The conditions there foster a feeling of such hopelessness that a 27-year-old even took his own life the very week that we debated this policy last, at the end of last year. A fellow asylum seeker and his roommate on the barge, Yusuf Dean Gargobu, spoke just today of how those living there, quote, and I quote, don't have any hope for their lives. That place is just not good for them. He says, and every day that their stress is increasing and getting worse. Presiding officer, in 2021, asylum applications in the United Kingdom reached over 81,000, largely due to war and to conflict. Asylum seekers are entitled to a roof over their head and little more. They are not allowed to work and have no access to public funds in the form of benefits and social security. These rights are only granted if they become refugees or recognised as refugees, which, due to horrendous Home Office backlogs, can still take months or even years. Those who aren't granted asylum often find themselves in destitution and at risk of exploitation, with only charities to rely on for support. Scottish Liberal Democrats believe that we have a human duty to offer protection and safe legal routes to people who are fleeing torment. We need the next UK government to create a dedicated arm's-length unit to make asylum decisions quickly and more fairly, with a new right to work for those who are seeking asylum if they have to wait longer than 3 months for a decision on their case, in order both to treat them more humanely and give them the chance to integrate in their communities and save the taxpayer tens of millions of pounds. Presiding officer, these are people who are hungry to contribute back to the society that is giving them refuge. We also welcome the recommendations of the recent report of the Human Rights and Asylum Seekers in Scotland. Those seeking safe harbour should always be treated with our utmost respect, always. And our approach should be guided by compassion and rooted in human rights and respect for international law. Seekers should be entitled to education and information about their rights, particularly in relation to health and mental health. They should not be asked to travel the length and breadth of the British Isles for an assessment interview. Scottish local authorities should be given the resources they need to provide the language and interpreter services, which are vital in helping people to settle here. We should also offer support to those third sector organisations who often provide the safety net for those applications who are denied. Liberal Democrats will always stand up for those who are marginalised and demonised. We care passionately about those on the other side of the planet that we may never meet, but some of whom are making their way here with a hope and a promise of home. And we stand against the dangerous rhetoric that we've heard from the Conservative benches in London. That is our obligation, presiding officer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole Hamilton. Before we move into the open debate, just a timely reminder to members that are participating in the debate, they should remain both for the opening and the closing speeches unless they have the permission of the chair. We now move to the open debate, and I call first Karen Adam to be followed by Donald Cameron. Around 6 minutes, Ms. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Everyone has the right to seek and to enjoy in other countries asylum from persecution. So reads Article 14 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the declaration which the United Kingdom played its part in drafting, the declaration which today the UK government sadly undermines at each and every turn. It's important to remind ourselves often and without apology of the context in which the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was drafted, a world riven by violence and hatred, full of displaced people and those fleeing persecution in the chaos that followed a war which we must again and again commit ourselves never to repeat. As we look on now from Scotland at the conflicts in Europe and the Middle East, it's hard not to ponder the solemn reality. It could be us, our children, our friends, or, as the case with the First Minister, our own relatives. History tells us that these conflicts do not occur in a vacuum, and we must play a part as a responsible member of the global community. It is heartbreaking to witness that despite what we see happening in the world right now, that the UK government continues its vindictive campaign against those who need our help most. I want to take some time today to dispel some of the myths peddled by the UK government and their Conservative defenders here in Scotland. They say we don't have enough room. Well, let's look at that a little bit more closely. Many of Scotland's communities, particularly in rural Scotland, are already experiencing acute depopulation and labour market challenges, in part because of Brexit and the end of the freedom of movement. Scotland is far from full, and as a country ready to take our share of those seeking refuge, we are unable to do so due to the fact that this is a reserved matter. The UK government must cease its culture wars, fulfil its international obligations and invest in tackling the asylum backlog, providing additional staff and ensuring more humane and efficient processes means that we could see a system fit for purpose. Instead, they've spent millions, hundreds of millions of pounds already on their inhumane and illegal Rwanda policy, which has resulted in what precisely? Not a single thing. An abhorrent and immoral waste of taxpayer money. They tell us we're being overrun, and often in the most inhumane ways. Former Prime Minister and now Foreign Secretary Lord Cameron once referred to a swarm of people coming across the Mediterranean. Sadly, he is not alone. Former Home Secretaries have referred to migrants as a hurricane and as an invasion. The Conservatives are trying to normalise such dehumanising language. Othering the most vulnerable in society is one of the oldest and, in my view, the most despicable tricks in the Tory handbook. Now, that won't wash here in Scotland, and we will see that reflected in the upcoming general election. We will see an end to the Scottish Conservatives. They ask us, how are we going to pay for them all? Well, those fleeing conflict and persecution and seeking asylum on our shores have much to offer our communities, culturally and economically. It's a shame, therefore, that the UK government continues to deny the right of those seeking asylum to work and to contribute to our country. As noted in the Building a New Scotland paper specifically looking at migration, we know that leaving the EU has cut off a valuable and ready supply of workers to fill key posts. There have been fewer births than deaths registered in Scotland since 2011, so it's clear that we need migration to ensure our communities are vibrant, diverse and thriving, and also to support local economies and the public sector. Last month, I met with fisheries stakeholders to discuss the detrimental impact that the proposed UK government immigration rules would have on the seafood processing sector. And during that meeting, numerous examples of seafood processing businesses, some of which are based in my constituency of Banffshire and Buchan Coast, comprise of workforces of up to 90% migrant workers. The one-size-fits-all, Britain bursting at the seams narrative simply doesn't ring true here in Scotland. And with both a hostile governing party and an indifferent opposition, it's clear that the only way for Scotland to have the levers to reverse projected population decline is in an independent country. And while the Conservatives scream, stop the boats, and I quote, dream and obsess of front pages of planes taken off to Rwanda, let me say this, Scotland has a different dream. And our dream would be for an asylum system founded on equality, opportunity and community. Three words which have been a bedrock for our Scottish Government in all it does. I want to conclude, Presiding Officer, by reminding the Chamber, it could be us. And if it were, would we not want those from whom we were seeking asylum to treat us with the fairness, dignity and respect which we deserve, to be treated as we would wish to be treated ourselves? Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. I now call Donald Cameron to be followed by Cocab Stewart. Around 6 minutes, Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to take part in this debate. Not because of the Scottish Government's position in their motion, predictable as their attack on UK government migration policy is. Predictable as the Minister's conclusion with its jarring and inappropriate reference to independence was. To Karen Adam, I should just point out the SNP government's 2013 independence white paper said that an independent Scotland would have a, quote, robust asylum policy that included the need for, quote, forced removal of failed asylum seekers. Now, it is quite ironic to be lectured about dignity, equality and opportunity when those words are found in the prospectus for independence that the SNP put forward to this country. But this debate does allow me, perhaps, as an individual, to shed a little light on the asylum system from a personal perspective, as a result of professional experiences gained as a lawyer representing asylum seekers here in Scotland? And can I refer to my register of interests as an advocate in that regard? Now, that experience was gained in the Asylum and Immigration Tribunal, as it was then called, in Bothwell Street in Glasgow. Interestingly, at a time, betraying my age here, when the Labour Party was in government at Westminster, and it's important to remember that the Labour Party ran this system for many, many years. And in the late 2000s, representing asylum seekers was a challenge for any lawyer. I never won a case arguing for asylum to be granted. It was almost impossible to consult with clients beforehand or even meet them face to face. Asylum seekers were kept in that tribunal in what most people would view as prison cells and would be brought out for their cases before being returned. Cases would be dealt with very swiftly, too swiftly, in my opinion. The Home Office presenting officer, or HOPO, as they were known colloquially, would present the case as to why asylum should be refused. The immigration judge would respectfully listen to people like me, but it was hard to make submissions about the facts on the grounds in countries in the developing world and argue that asylum should be granted in the UK in light of dangerous or risky conditions in the applicant's home country that were directly applicable to that particular individual in terms of fear or of persecution, and to do so with any credibility and confidence. So what to draw from this experience? And I can only speak from that point in time, that in late 2000s. It was a system that did not appear to be working for those seeking asylum. It was a system that was also not answering the legitimate concerns that many people had still have more widely about migration. And it was a system that even looked at impartially and independently as a professional trying simply to work in the system that did not appear effective. It was undeniably a challenging experience trying to act in the best interests of your client. And I wonder if much has changed in the last 15 years or so since I was in that tribunal. But there have been some changes. There has been an administrative overhaul of the tribunal system, and in defence of the UK government, as our amendment states, it should be recognised that the UK government spent £3.7 billion in the fiscal year 2022-23 to support refugees. Just as it should also be recognised that the same UK government continues to provide asylum seekers with financial support to cover essential living needs and is committed to delivering an asylum system that protects individuals from persecution based on their protected characteristics. In terms of the other points raised in this debate, I have very little to add to the skillful and measured opening speech of Miles Briggs and his fundamental point that he closed with, that both the Scottish Government and the UK Government should work together. It is just a shame that we are yet again debating a reserve matter and not a policy that falls within the Scottish Government's own remit. Yes, I would. Yeah.
Bob Dorris.
I thank Donald Cameron for giving away. In terms of that partnership working, Glasgow could be facing hundreds of families who have had a positive decision to be welcome in their asylum claims, all entering the homeless system in Glasgow at the same time, without one single penny coming from the UK government to support them and Glasgow for that. Do you not think partnership working means to be a funding model that means the UK government contributes towards that, Mr Cameron?
Donald Cameron.
My response to that is to point him to the comments of Susan Aitken, his party colleague, who said she would fight plans to relocate more asylum seekers in Glasgow. I would like to develop one theme that has not been...
Point of order, Bob Dorris.
I apologise for doing this, presiding officer, because you will rightly probably tell me it's not a point of order. That was a really important comment Mr Cameron made. I genuinely couldn't hear it, and I think it's quite important to the debate that I hear what Mr Cameron said, so I apologise. Could you please repeat that comment?
Donald Cameron. It isn't a point of order, just for the record, but Donald Cameron.
I'll just continue. I'm running out of time, presiding officer. I'd like to develop one theme that hasn't been covered, and that concerns Ukraine and the super sponsor scheme. When the Minister gave evidence to the Constitution Committee last month, I asked her about this scheme. I asked her whether there was any intention to restart it. She said that the government had been reviewing the pause with the next review happening this month. Perhaps she can answer now or in closing. Has that review happened? Are we any closer to reopening the scheme? Because I have to suggest to her that this has been a failure. by the Scottish Government. It was announced with great fanfare, but it has been beset with problems. We know that earlier last year there were reports that some 7,500 Ukrainians, including almost 1,900 children, were stuck in temporary accommodation. We know that the government slashed the resettlement budget by more than £25 million. And we know that the SNP government will no longer renew the £10 million in funding that it initially granted to local councils to support Ukrainian resettlement, with Edinburgh City Council, I think, describing it as a betrayal. And what was dressed up as a warm Scots welcome and a warm Scots future has, in many cases, ended up being neither. So to conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, it is a shame that this debate has already descended into an attack on UK government policy. There are important issues, especially around housing in Scotland, which are crucial. And I'm sorry that this debate has taken the course it has already. We should instead be concentrating on what the Scottish Government can do, what local government can do here and now in Scotland to make life better for asylum seekers. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Cameron. I now call COCAB Stewart to be followed by Pauline McNeill. Around 6 minutes, Ms Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm fortunate to represent one of the most diverse constituencies of Glasgow Kelvin, and people from all corners of the globe pay Scotland the ultimate compliment by choosing to call our country their home. And whilst we set out our vision of an internationally responsible, welcoming and compassionate country, we do so under the blatant hostile narrative set by the UK government that seeks to constantly undermine our vision. Those who come here do so at the mercy of an unimaginable, cruel, Tory UK government that is determined to vilify foreigners and to use them as a scapegoat for their own woeful mismanagement. It is a government which in the last year has traded one Home Secretary who dreamed of deporting asylum seekers to Rwanda to the current one who reportedly thinks that the policy is complete bat stuff but is pursuing it anyway. Rwanda, who knew it would be the hill that the current Prime Minister would choose to stake his reputation on? The flagship Tory policy that will do nothing to address the plight of the desperate being put in great danger at the hands of organised criminals in the English Channel. Members are aware that the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee last year published its report on the lived experience of asylum seekers in Scotland, and the report made several recommendations which I'm encouraged that the Scottish Government is taking seriously, notably the commitment to provide concessionary bus travel, which I welcome. Mr Cameron, my colleague, mentioned having budgets that fund asylum seekers. I don't know anyone who thinks that £9.58 a week, which is what asylum seekers actually received if they are housed in accommodation, can actually provide any way of being able to get by. So with no recourse to public funds, asylum seekers are expected to meet all their weekly costs that life brings on less than a tenner. That is simply not enough. And of course, asylum seekers are forbidden to work by UK law, from taking up employment to support themselves and their families while their applications are processed. And this process can last many months or even years. And that's after the Home Office has conducted what they call a substantive review. Asylum seekers' ban on taking up employment is not the norm. The USA, Canada, Germany, Australia and many other nations do allow those applying for asylum the chance to get a job and earn a living. People should be able to earn a living and integrate into their new communities. The new Scots Refugee Integration Strategy recognises strength skills as well as committing to better access to essential services. And, Presiding Officer, I now go on to the Illegal Migration Act. In my view, that is one of the most callous pieces of legislation introduced by this UK government in my living memory. In a country with no legal system of applying for asylum, beyond a select few nation-specific schemes, the Illegal Migration Act now means that someone seeking asylum faces being detained indefinitely, left in a permanent state of uncertainty, and under constant threat of deportation. And for those who are victims of human trafficking, the new Act simply wipes away the protections given in the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Act. Andy Cyril of Just Rights Scotland told the committee, "This is the situation in which victim centres support in a devolved area, which has been provided for the last 8 years, is working fairly well, will be extinguished with the stroke of a pen at Westminster. Those who will be most affected include women who are victims of sex trafficking and young men who are coerced into engaging in organised crime. Brona Andrew of Tara has stated that the Illegal Migration Act will disapply the powers of the Scottish Government to create a national referral mechanism. It will limit their ability to link women with Police Scotland and have access to justice. In its 2017 report, Hidden Lives, New Beginnings, the Equalities, Human Rights and Committee that was convened at that time by Minister Christina McKelvey looked in detail at the many challenges faced by those going through the asylum system in Scotland. And it included access to healthcare, looking at the links between destitution, exploitation and psychological trauma, and the protection and care of children of asylum seekers. I would be grateful if the Minister could update the Chamber on the work that the Scottish Government has done to address the recommendations from that report. Presiding Officer, it marks 14 years since the Tories came into power, but the chipping away at the asylum seekers' right didn't start with them. The so-called hostile environment was started by Labour, a phrase coined by Labour Immigration Minister at that time, Liam Byrne, in 2007. Now, 2024 may well be the year that we see the Tories out of government, but so far Labour are not offering anything different. But I am pleased to hear today that they would scrap the Rwanda scheme. And my challenge to Labour is this: devolve immigration to Scotland so we can build a better and fairer system that meets our needs. Work with the SNP to establish a fairer system of applying for asylum in the UK with safeguards and legal routes. Commit to supporting asylum seekers' right to work while they're here. Scrap the awful illegal migration bill. And in closing, Presiding Officer, I do believe that an independent Scotland offers the opportunity to ensure that asylum and migration policy is set according to Scotland's needs. And through the proposals set out in the Scottish Government's Building a New Scotland, we can be good global citizens and create a sensible and open, fair and welcome migration system. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Stewart. I now call Pauline McNeill to be followed by Bob Doris, around 6 minutes. Ms McNeill.
Asylum is normally granted in the UK if a person is unable to live safely in any part of their own country because of a potential persecution on the grounds of race, religion, nationality, political opinion or anything else that puts them at risk because of the social, cultural, religious or political situation in their home country. Or at least that was the policy we've had for many years. But in fact, the UK has signed up to treaties, as the Minister said in her opening speech, reflecting these principles. Priti Patel has long gone, but the UK government plans on immigration right now could not be more against these treaty principles. It's disastrous, it's callous, it's completely inefficient into the bargain. It is becoming an international joke on the back of a recent court decision that we've heard on the Rwanda policy. And we're spending millions to the French to get their cooperation preventing migrants from coming here. And even the French are saying that the UK is failing on our end. I would echo the Scottish Refugees Council's principle that we are a strong and resilient nation, and we can and should do much better than this. There is indeed a correlation between geopolitical matters, including conflict, and the extent of migration. It is a highly sensitive and political issue, and it does require an understanding of all politicians that world affairs, be it migration due to climate change or war, has an implication on migration. So we know that after 40 years of conflict in the recent Taliban government, the Afghan refugees, the third largest displaced population in the world, with over 1.6 million, of which Britain had some responsibility, fled the country in 2021. Well, we didn't do a great deal of service to the Afghans, for not all of them were allowed to flee to the UK. Since Russia's invasion of the Ukraine in 2022, 38,000 Ukrainians have taken advantage of the UK government's super sponsor programme. So there have been programmes that are very welcome, and they do show that this is the way in which we can support people in other countries fleeing persecution. As we witness the longest, deepest offensive in the Gaza Strip, as an example, there will be geopolitical consequences of the ethnic cleansing of the Palestinian population. And whilst we must robustly resist forced evacuation in the occupied territory of Gaza as it faces obliteration, there will be, inevitably, a percentage of the population who will seek refuge in the rest of the world. So we must live up to our responsibilities where we are involved. In Glasgow, there are 5,500 people in asylum-supported accommodation, and 1,800 of those people are in 21 institutional hotels across 13 local authorities. On average, there are in these environments for at least 9 months, often stuck in state-imposed with severe poverty, forced unemployment, and very few people are permitted to access any work, as we've heard. But Home Office decision-making has fallen again in terms of the backlog of asylum cases. They don't seem to be able to ever get this under control and has drastically increased, leading the months of long waits for claims to be processed. The Home Office has also begun its hotel maximisation policy. It's one of the aspects of the policy that makes me most uncomfortable. Compulsory room sharing for hotel and hostel residents in Scotland. I believe it's totally unacceptable and does not fit with the principles of any of the treaties that the UK has signed up to. It can be extremely traumatising for those individuals. Hotels can often be isolated areas anyway, making it more difficult for the people living there to access community support services that they need. We've seen tragedies unfold as a result of these types of conditions. Back in 2020, the asylum seeker Badreddin Abdallah Adam made 72 calls for help to the Home Office, and the charity Migrant Help before killing, he killed six people in the Glasgow Park Inn, an absolute tragedy. During the pandemic leading up to the tragedy, Glasgow asylum seekers were removed from their residencies to be placed in hotels, simultaneously being stripped of their £35 weekly support allowance, and 3 years later, this is down to £9 a week. I don't regard this as being a dignified existence. In this particular accommodation, residents were unable to socially distance or buy things like mobile phone top-ups in order to stay in touch with their families or indeed their lawyers back home. 16 others have died in asylum seeking accommodation in Scotland since 2016, some taking their own lives. Events like this should never happen. So that's why it's really important that local authorities are funded adequately in order to play the role that they want to play. And I am proud of my city of Glasgow, who has historically played an important role in all of this. Just in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I think that the Rwanda policy, which many members have talked about, I think it's important to understand that Supreme Court decision. Because one of the reasons that the Supreme Court came to the view that it did is because they did not believe that Rwandan authorities would make fair decisions in relation to claimants. And it's important to note that even in cases where the person had a successful application, they would never ever see the United Kingdom. It is a bizarre, strange and completely callous policy. Across Europe, many countries are facing similar challenges, and immigration is very often talked about in a negative way. And in fact, I'd like to think, and I think many members in this parliament, I think there is some common ground here, see immigration as a positive thing. I think Scotland should play its role. I believe it can play its role as a devolved parliament, and I look forward to hearing the other contributions, because I do think that Scotland can do more and play a more strategic and positive role in immigration and asylum seeking.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. I now call Bob Doris to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Around 6 minutes, Mr Doris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland should rightly be proud of our record of welcoming refugees and asylum seekers, as well as migrants more generally. We should acknowledge the moral responsibility nations have, including, of course, Scotland, to meet our international humanitarian obligations and the imperative to have an ethical and humane asylum and immigration system. We should also be clear and acknowledge the huge contribution that migrants to Scotland make to our society, the vital roles that many play right across society, be that in the care sector, our NHS, in science and technology, in research and higher education, in our business community, and much, much more. Just think what more they could do if they were all allowed to work. But also the contribution that migrants make to our arts and cultural communities and how they enrich society more generally. I want to pay my thanks to the contribution migrants make to the communities I am privileged to represent. That national responsibility Scotland has is clearly complicated by the reserved nature of immigration and asylum policies. And let's be clear, the UK government responsibility to fund appropriately the support required across Scotland's local authorities to ensure that both vulnerable refugee families have come to Scotland and our wider communities are appropriately supported. I want to spend much of my speech focusing on this matter, but before I do, let me put on record what I consider to be the UK government's approach to asylum and immigration more generally. My constituents expect me to do so, and I do find it repugnant. Trying to offshore moral obligations for refugees to Rwanda, seeking to demonise those who come to our shores on boats, given the dearth of any legal routes to the UK that they could use, and tacitly encouraging the normalisation of right-wing rhetoric across society are just some of the aspects of the UK's discourse on immigration that I am deeply concerned about. As imperfect and flawed as the current asylum system is, and despite this being reserved, the Scottish Government and our councils have a clear duty to do all they can to have a welcoming, integrated and inclusive approach to the immigration and asylum system. It is not only the right thing to do, it is in our self-interest, given the needs of our economy and public sector to have a committed, skilled and growing working-age population. Migration to Scotland makes a key contribution in that respect. The Scottish Government has rightly highlighted in its motion concerns over the increased reliance on contingency asylum accommodation caused by a backlog in Home Office decision-making and various other concerns, but I want to focus on the streamlined asylum process and limited move-on period allowed once a decision has been made, that fast-tracking that we've heard about this afternoon. Well, what does that mean for Glasgow? Well, rather than a manageable flow of asylum seekers staying in the city requiring to be rehoused from Mayor's accommodation into mainstream accommodation after they secure a positive decision, there will be a significant spike in the numbers for the city to manage without one penny of additional financial support from the UK government. And let us remember that spike is due to the UK Home Office having a dreadful record and failing to determine asylum decisions timely over many, many years. I've referred to a spike, presiding officer, but what we're talking about is vulnerable asylum-seeking families in very large numbers, having to move from designated asylum accommodation they're currently in into a homelessness system without the UK offering any financial support. That cannot be fair on anyone. When I met with mayors at the start of December last year, they indicated there were 560 positive decisions overstairs, mainly in Glasgow, defined as being in mayor's accommodation 28 days after that positive decision. I'm unclear how many of those positive overstairs are now homeless. To have no UK funds following a positive decision was always unfair on councils, but to potentially have hundreds of families being made homeless within a short space of time and there to be no UK government financial support, it's scandalous. It's not fair on the families facing homelessness, asylum seeking or otherwise, and it's not fair in Glasgow. There is an acknowledgement from the UK government there's initial costs on local authorities when they first host a vulnerable asylum seeker. Every time a bed is identified, it triggers a payment of £3,500. Why no acknowledgement of the need to offer support to local authorities when vulnerable asylum seekers are at a point of transition into our mainstream system? It makes no sense. I also discussed with mayors how they work with councils across Scotland to ensure we have a Scotland-wide approach to supporting asylum-seeking families. It was encouraging to hear that councils out with Glasgow are working constructively to identify 2,000 additional bed spaces around 600 to 700 properties. But that led to a discussion about how mayors, or the council indeed, could work with asylum-seeking families ahead of any positive decision to prepare them for transition. For instance, could they help them save for a deposit for a private rented property in the future, but if only they were allowed to work, presiding officer, eh? Or could they discuss with them about what their housing options may be more generally? Would families wish to remain in Glasgow understandable as kids maybe at school, or there may be roots put down in communities. Would families consider moving elsewhere in Scotland, and what support package could be offered to do so? What would accommodation options look like? What would schools look like? What are the local amenities in any given area? Are there support networks elsewhere in Scotland, should families wish to do so? I should also put on record, I'm happy for them to stay in Glasgow, but there should be options, and these things should be planned. The response I received from mayors that it is not only were such systems not in place, they were specifically restricted by the Home Office from any kind of conversation of that nature whatsoever. That is crazy. That is wrong. And that is unacceptable. In closing, Presiding Officer, I understand there's a test for change group, which includes Glasgow City Council, Home Office, the Scottish Refugee Council, and mayors looking at solutions on housing issues. I'd welcome an update from the Scottish Government where that has got to. But finally, a lot has been made in the Chamber this afternoon about this being a polarised debate about visions for our immigration and asylum system and the kinds of society we want to be. It absolutely is. But I obviously also live in the here and now. In my communities and my vulnerable asylum-seeking families, they need support in the here and now also. And that has to involve partnership work between the UK Government, the Scottish Government, Scotland's councils and all our stakeholders, vitally including those with lived experience. And I commend the Scottish Government's motion here this afternoon.
Thank you. And I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you. I want to thank organisations, communities and individuals who work day in, day out, supporting asylum seekers. I pay tribute to Grampian Regional Equality Council and Dundee International Women's Centre for their work across the North East, and of course the Scottish Refugee Council. We've heard that we shouldn't be having this debate, that as immigration is a reserved matter, we can cheerfully and with clear consciences leave it to those wise men and women of Westminster. But this is one of those moments when history will judge us by what we say and do, or by how we keep silent. For the scandal that is UK asylum policy and legislation is already having disastrous impacts at multiple levels, internationally, for the UK, for Scotland, for our communities, and most of all, for the people and families that the asylum system is supposed to protect. Globally, passing the Illegal Migration Act represents a serious blow to the UK's standing. While the British reputation for decency and fair play has often been undeserved, it is the case that people and organisations in the UK have played significant roles in developing international human rights and asylum systems. It is the greatest of insults to these hard-working, courageous pioneers that their country is now seen as a rogue state, a reputation which, now gained, will be very hard to lose. Who'd have thought it possible that a UK government would pass laws that admit, on their very face, that they are not compliant with our most basic human rights? This reputation is an international humiliation, but it's also worrying that others may be tempted to follow the UK's lead. If the UK, with all its prosperity and advantages, can disregard shared humanity and international law, others will ask why they shouldn't do the same. In the UK, these policies and the rhetoric behind them are doing incalculable damage to our political and public discourse. The crude violence of the stop the boats messaging would have been unthinkable just a few years ago. And the level of opposition from moderate Tories and the official opposition has been woefully weak. It is my profound hope that their consciences will overcome their cynical calculations of electoral advantage, not least because those calculations are very likely to be wrong. Despite the extraordinary media messaging over many years, messages of spite, bile, and blatant untruth, most people are not xenophobic border obsessives, but compassionate citizens who recognise themselves in those seeking refuge and welcome them as neighbours, colleagues and friends. Here in Scotland, we have long recognised the value of people coming from elsewhere for our community, culture, identity and economy. That tradition of welcome and mutual enrichment is deeply rooted and remains strong and vibrant, though its practical manifestations are made much more difficult by actions of the UK government. Demographically and culturally, we know, as politicians and commentators in England seem to have forgotten, that we need new Scots. The motion recognises also that the pernicious impact of Westminster policies is especially painful for our local authorities, those who already host and support people seeking asylum, and those who want to do more. Our councils are impossibly being prevented from carrying out their fundamental duties to provide essential services to those most in need. Finally, and most importantly, those inhuman and illegal policies are having tragic effects for our new and potential Scots neighbours, on people seeking asylum here, including those in situations of deep danger, longing for refuge, those who have embarked on long and perilous journeys, those already here awaiting decisions from a cruel and dilatory Home Office, those who have received their refugee status, and many others affected by the hostile environment and discourses of demonisation. Those blows fall most heavily upon the vulnerable, especially upon victims of trafficking, whose rights and means of redress have been essentially shredded by the Illegal Migration Act. They fall upon children, including young teenagers whose age is disbelieved by the Home Office, and the youngest babies and toddlers placed in institutional accommodation with few, if any, opportunities to play, crawl, walk, and reach the other essential milestones of child development. UK policies represent a failure of compliance with international law, a failure of humanity, and a failure of imagination. I implore all those who think these policies acceptable to take a moment to imagine themselves faced with the horrific choices which have to be made by those in danger of persecution, imprisonment, or death. Think about the dangerous journeys made, the homes, families, friends, lives left behind. Then imagine that when you finally reach what should be a place of safety, the fear continues, fear of attack by hostile far-right actors, trauma reawakened by windowless rooms that feel like cells, anxiety and sleeplessness triggered by rooms shared with strangers. Think about the simple actions we here take for granted. Sufficient money to catch a bus to an essential appointment, to phone a family member, to buy a child a small toy or treat. Think about having studied and worked for years, perhaps in a much-needed medical or caring role, and not being allowed to use those skills for the community around you, not being allowed to work at all, but left, maybe for years, in a limbo of indignity and lack of information. And at the end of all that waiting, when the decision finally comes that, yes, what you said was true, you are indeed a refugee, imagine that decision coming along with the news that you have but a few days before being evicted from your accommodation, with little hope of finding a home or escaping further destitution. These are the realities behind the brash slogan of Stop the Boats. Not boats stopped, but lives, families, and communities broken and bereft. Asylum seekers, all human beings, deserve better.
Thank you. And I call Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I cannot see a rationale or justification for an approach to asylum determination that takes years, costs the taxpayer extraordinary amounts, and that prevents the individual from contributing to the economy and society. Not my words, but those of Helena Kennedy QC as Chair of Independent Commission of Inquiry into Asylum Provision in Scotland. We should at this point remind ourselves that the UK is a signatory to the 1951 Refugee Convention and the 1967 Protocol, which serves to protect refugees. The Convention defines a refugee as someone who has a well-founded fear of being persecuted for reasons of race, religion, nationality, membership of a particular social group or political opinion, and is outside the country of their nationality. The latest figures for the 12 months to September 23 states that 75,340 asylum applications were made to the Home Office relating to 93,296 people. In terms of the number of asylum applications per head of population, the UK ranks 20th highest in Europe, very far behind other countries like Cyprus, who top that table for asylum applications per head of population. The Refugee Council identified that the top five countries of origin of people seeking asylum in the UK were from Afghanistan, Iran, Albania, India and Iraq. Two of the countries are where British troops engaged in armed conflict for many years, and one where human rights abuses, particularly against women and girls, has been well documented, and others as a result of crackdown on independence movements or sectarian violence. That is why 75% of people who apply for asylum in the UK are granted protection on their initial application. As of September 23, 124,000 people were waiting the conclusion of their asylum application. Meanwhile, those same people seeking asylum are banned from working and in many cases are provided with £9 a week from the UK government to cover the cost of their basic necessities. This is at a time when across the UK there are currently 949,000 vacancies that need to be filled to help the Scottish and UK's economy to grow. Why are we not using those individuals who have been granted protection in this country to work to support themselves? The National Institute of Economic and Social Research in its discussion paper states the economic and social impacts of lifting work restrictions on people seeking asylum highlights that the UK is only one of six European nations who grant asylum applicants the right to work after they have been waiting for an outcome of their application for longer than a year. Unlike most other countries where this restriction is 6 months. However, the UK is the only country to impose further restrictions on what jobs a person seeking an asylum can apply for once the right to work has been granted, by allowing people to only take up jobs on a shortage occupation list. The report found that the annual impact from allowing people seeking asylum the right to work in the UK would be to increase tax revenue by £1.3 billion, reduce government expenditure by £6.7 billion and increase the UK's GDP by £1.6 billion. As Helena Kennedy stated in the final report of the Commission, what an utter waste of human potential and of resources, particularly in a country that has an urgent growth agenda and massive skill shortages. She continued, the UK needs care workers, HGV drivers, butchers and other technical and professional skilled workers. We need to honour our commitments to protect people and we need people who want to play a role in our economy and society. Canada's recent announced 23-25 immigration level plan embraces a strategy of immigration to manage future social and economic challenges. They see immigration as an opportunity, not a threat. In contrast, the UK seems short-sighted on multiple fronts. End quote. Many refugees are highly skilled and want to contribute to their new country to say thanks for the opportunity to rebuild their lives. But instead, the UK government has left over 56,000 of them languishing in hotel rooms, resulting in increased mental health issues, ongoing trauma and loss of well-being, resulting in them requiring more support from already stretched NHS. The recently published Scottish Government's immigration proposals in Building a New Scotland would welcome asylum seekers and would provide support so they could more easily integrate into communities. People seeking asylum would be given the right to work and therefore would pay taxes, which in turn would allow access to public services, including employability support. The result would be increased tax revenue for the Scottish Government, lower expenditure on asylum support and increased productivity. Presiding Officer, the UK Government's repugnant policies on asylum and immigration in no way reflect Scotland's values of compassion, humanity and hope in upholding international law, nor do they take into account that migration benefits Scotland's economy and our public services. An independent Scotland would be able to establish a humane approach to supporting refugees and people fleeing conflict and persecution who deserve our compassion and aid, and be aware of the need for equity of the Global South and our approach to migration. We would be able to do this with values of dignity, fairness and respect at the heart of all aspects of immigration policy.
Thank you. And I call Paul Sweeney to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Conservative UK Government descends into electoral oblivion, they have resorted to ever more desperate acts, most notably their cynical project to make the asylum system as inhumane as possible, shipping people seeking safety from horrendous situations such as war and persecution off to Rwanda. Not only has it been an appalling waste of public money, but it is also a waste of life. Three quarters of asylum claims are granted at the initial decision, and over half of appeals are successful. That means that almost 9 out of every 10 people seeking asylum in Britain end up being granted refugee status. £140 million has already been paid to Rwanda, yet not a single asylum seeker has been sent, thankfully, as the Supreme Court ruled the policy unlawful in November. But the public funds wasted on this atrocious scheme work out at £1,500 for each of the 93,296 people who sought asylum in the UK in the last 12 months. Just think what we could have done with that money instead. The eccentric and unlawful Rwanda gimmick is just one element of the cruel Tory asylum policy that strips people of all hope and humanity when they need it most. You just have to look at the conditions on the Bibby Stockholm barge to see the aim of the UK government's asylum policy. Such a policy demonstrates nothing but hostility to people we should be opening our arms to. Those asylum seekers banned from working to pay for their own lodgings and instead housed in barges and in hotels don't feel safe. Where is the empathy in forcing people that have fled war and persecution into rooms without windows for long periods of time? It is no wonder that asylum seekers are at heightened risk of experiencing depression and post-traumatic stress disorder. And the UK government's efforts to clear the asylum backlog whilst cutting the so-called move-on period in which refugee status is granted and asylum accommodation provisions end heightens the risk of mass homelessness and destitution for people seeking asylum in Scotland. We must do all that is possible to ensure refugees and asylum seekers do not end up homeless. That is why it is bitterly disappointing that the Ukrainian resettlement team in Glasgow are winding down their operations in order to merge with the General Asylum and Refugee Team. The work of the Specialist Ukrainian Resettlement Team is vitally important in ensuring a smooth transition from asylum accommodation and for other refugees. This merger will not only increase the chance of Ukrainian refugees slipping through the cracks and ending up without a roof over their heads. The Scottish Government promised a warm welcome for all Ukrainian refugees, but with homelessness rates higher amongst Ukrainians than the wider population, it is clear that they have fallen short of their promise. The Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee's report into asylum seekers and refugees in Scotland suggested that the Scottish Government could do much more to ease the situation of asylum seekers in Scotland, and the decision to bring about concessionary bus travel for asylum seekers is welcomed, but there are other practical improvements that must be explored. Happy to give way.
Bob Doris.
Thank you, President Officer, and thank you, Mr Sweeney. I'm just hoping Mr Sweeney would take this opportunity to put on record that he would agree with me that the point of transition from a positive decision by the UK Home Office for an asylum-seeking family into the mainstream system within Glasgow, or another local authority, Mr Sweeney, that there should be a financial payment from the UK Government to support that, and that would be a reasonable thing for any future UK Government to also support.
I don't think what the member has proposed is unreasonable in the slightest. In fact, I would be inclined to support his suggestion. However, I don't think it is at all helped by the Scottish Government's recent announcement of cutting the capital budget for housing and seriously constraining council budgets, which means that the opportunity for councils to manage that transition is seriously harmed. And I think we need to seriously address that, and the government here should take responsibility for that decision. The Home Office certainly keep families separated in the desperation of conflict apart, and wondering if they'll ever be reunited. And I particularly want to raise, Presiding Officer, one case that has been brought to my attention recently, the ongoing plight of Kaltuma Haroon Ibrahim. Mrs Ibrahim is a much-loved member of the Gorbals Parish Church in Glasgow. She studies English at Annie's Lang College and works part-time with disabled children for Glasgow City Council. In 2014, alongside her husband and 5 children, Mrs Ibrahim boarded a boat in Libya bound for Italy after fleeing war-torn Sudan. But tragically, the boat sank and 2 of her children, Mohammed and Faisal, drowned. She was separated from her 3 surviving children and husband in the aftermath of the tragedy. And after being forced to give up her search to find her family, she returned to her birthplace of Chad. Yet Chad is terrorised by the violent Islamist militant group Boko Haram. and she again was forced to flee to France and then on to London, claiming asylum there in 2016. Mrs. Ibrahim moved to Glasgow in 2017 and secured refugee status in 2019. Thanks to a humanitarian charity, Mrs. Ibrahim managed to track down her husband and teenage children who are living in war-torn Sudan. Around 15 months ago, her lawyer submitted the required paperwork to the Home Office so that her family could join her in Glasgow. Within that time, horrifically, her 13-year-old daughter, Safa, perished in a rocket attack near her home in Khartoum. The situation Mrs. Ibrahim and her family are in is deeply distressing, as I'm sure all members will agree. It is astonishing that it should take so long to process such a case. I ask, therefore, if the Minister here would be willing to take a direct action and make representations on behalf of the Scottish Government to the UK Government on behalf of Mrs. Ibrahim in Glasgow, so that we can end the decade of torment and tragedy and reunite what remains of this shattered family.
Thank you. And I call Rona Mackay, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK Government's asylum policy and legislation is a muddled mess and creates anxiety and downright hostility to those who come here looking for safety and security. The complex and inhumane system denies people who come to Scotland to work, raise their families and settle into our society. And make no mistake, Presiding Officer, we need immigration. Scotland is not full. We welcome the diversity and enrichment from everyone coming to these shores. The Scottish Government's vision for Scotland is one of an internationally responsible, welcoming and compassionate country. This is in complete contrast to the UK Government's disgusting policies, which in no way reflect Scotland's values of compassion, humanity and upholding international law. And nor do they take into account that migration benefits Scotland's economy and our public services. The Scottish Government is developing mitigations as far as possible within our devolved powers and budget, including through our new Scots Refugee Integration Strategy. As the Minister outlined, work is underway in partnership with the Scottish Refugee Council and COSLA to inform the refresh of the new Scots Refugee Integration Strategy. And the Minister spoke in her opening speech about the plight of women and babies with no idea what their future will be. What a desperate situation. With independence, we can focus on Scotland's priorities, create a system which eradicates human trafficking and also create a migration system that has fairness and dignity at its heart. In a recently published Building a New Scotland paper, we propose that an independent Scotland would have humane, fair and compassionate refugee and asylum policies. A flexible visa system would help Scottish businesses to attract and retain the international talent they need to thrive. Presiding Officer, I recently met a young asylum seeker who'd gained a degree in computer science and was looking to complete her master's in that subject. Her asylum appeal had not been confirmed, but she was desperate to stay here and contribute to our society. Why on earth would any country not want her to do that? But we also need not just the brightest brains, but people who want to work in all sectors of our society, as Gordon MacDonald outlined, and educate and bring up their children here in a safe environment. Because Scotland has a long history of welcoming refugees and asylum seekers and recognises it's a human right to be able to seek asylum in another country. What does it say about a society when it cannot welcome those fleeing conflict and persecution? I cannot fathom the mindset that thinks it's acceptable to create a hostile environment and look for ways to turn people back or export them to an entirely unsuitable country, such as Rwanda. Despite the Supreme Court ruling in relation to the safety of Rwanda, the UK Government persists in trying to prove them wrong, knowing better, in order to complete this incomprehensible plan, and I think that says it all. Those fleeing conflict and persecution should be protected and welcomed. We can't turn our backs on people impacted by conflicts across the world who have been killed trying to escape or facing illness due to the lack of clean water and medical assistance. Whether they come from Sudan, Gaza, Ukraine or Afghanistan, the UK should be providing sanctuary for the most vulnerable, not holding them in hotels or trying to ship them off to Rwanda to be put in even more danger. Presiding Officer, we're talking about children and families here. Financial support provided to people seeking asylum should reflect the real costs of daily life, including digital access and travel costs. And the Scottish Government has also raised concerns about the impact of the UK Government's streamlined asylum process. The Minister for Refugees, as we heard, wrote to the UK Government to request urgent funding for local authorities and to work constructively with them.
to ensure that people receiving a positive asylum decision are supported to move on from asylum accommodation. Instead of creating a culture war that attacks the most vulnerable, the Tories should be investing in clearing the backlog and creating safe and legal routes to those fleeing war and persecution. And I would like to mention our many amazing third sector organisations working flat out to support migrants every day. And we need them, because Westminster have made it clear that they couldn't care less about some of the most vulnerable people in the world. But the Human Rights Act is a key protection for every citizen in the UK, including rights of asylum seekers. Presiding officer, I'd also like to highlight the scandal of the fact that migrant women in the UK fleeing domestic abuse have no recourse to public funds. Do they not matter? Should they not receive care and protection in the country where they're living? The Scottish Government cannot amend restrictions placed on people seeking asylum while they await a decision, including long-standing UK government policies to restrict the right to work and access to public funds. So it's high time to devolve immigration to Scotland so that we can ditch the appalling Illegal Migration Act and show some compassion and respect to refugees. Because refugees are desperate people fleeing war and persecution, and Scotland has repeatedly voted for a more compassionate and welcoming approach. And as Karen Adams said, it could be any of us, it could be us. So I think we need the chance to implement the policies that reflect the values of Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Faisal Chowdhury, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recent hostile UK government policies have contributed to Scotland being painted as a country that does not welcome refugees. These policies have encouraged hostility and bad feelings towards those in our society who are most vulnerable. This fear of other, rhetoric strokes racism, puts immigrants in danger and deprives the UK of the benefits migrants bring. Just this week, there were reports that a far-right activist had posed as Home Office inspector to get information about a Dumfries hotel that was housing refugees. Even more shockingly, the Scottish Refugee Council have reported that suicide amongst asylum seekers in Home Office accommodations have doubled in the last 4 years. This is due to a series of UK government asylum policies that seek to address migrants as a horde of illegal people coming to the UK instead of safeguarding the well-being of migrants already in the country. As Miles Briggs mentioned, CPG Bangladesh recently visited Cox's Bazar refugee camp, and I refer members to my register of interest. It was great to see the positive impact of foreign funding for Rohingya refugees in Bangladesh. It is disappointing that we have not seen this reflected in the Home Office's recent asylum policies. Labour wants to see an end to costly and unacceptable asylum policies set out by the Home Office. Presiding Officer, despite being a reserved matter, UK government asylum policy directly affect Scotland and many devolved areas of competence within. Under the recent UK hostile crackdown on migration, many asylum seekers in Scotland will be required to seek legal aid, housing and help from Scottish local authorities. Not to mention the potential overwhelming of Scotland's only immigration detention centre, Dungable House. The Minister, Emma Reddick, outlined that 80% of Scots also want to see a well-managed approach to asylum. Labour wants the immigration system to work for all, part of our country. We want a fair, controlled asylum system which supports refugees fleeing persecution while keeping our borders secure and ensuring all accepted claims are legitimate. Currently, the Tories are outsourcing borders security to criminal smuggler gangs. That is why a UK Labour government will reform and strengthen the the Migration Advisory Committee with appropriate input from across the UK. So the visa system works for all nations and regions, including Scotland. Jacob Stewart outlined how it is, how as it stands, the Illegal Migration Act can disapply the power of the Scottish Parliament. When the UK government announced the Act in March last year, the Scottish government promised action to mitigate the damage it would do in Scotland. We are close to a year, and Just Right Scotland, amongst other, continued to warn the danger to unaccompanied minors and victims of trafficking in Scotland under this Act. The UK Supreme Court have recently ruled the so-called Rwanda plans as unlawful. Yet, strict rules around asylum and leave to remain have left many asylum seekers in Scotland and indefinite limbo, not being removed but unable to access concrete help. The UK government continues to create down a path of policies that strips refugees of their rights to ship them to third countries. A move that Alex Cole Hamilton rightly observed that bluntly laid aside key aspects of our human rights legislation. Karen Adam spoke of how the UK government does this instead of investing in tackling the asylum backlogs. Finally, Presiding Officer, as Paul O'Kane mentioned, the report by the Equalities Human Rights Civil Justice Committee recommended that the Scottish Government use powers within the full competence of the Scottish Parliament to improve the lives of asylum seekers in Scotland. The harm caused by UK Government asylum policies can be mitigated in Scotland. However, over the decade of underfunding for local authorities, vital service provided to refugees at risk. The Scottish Government's future refugee strategy must seek to protect refugees in all devolved areas, ensuring help within housing, transport, employability, access to health care, including mental health, and protection from organised crime. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Jeremy Balfour. Up to 7 minutes, Mr. Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It frustrates me no end that we seem to spend an incredible amount of time in this Scottish Parliament debating issues that are not within our competency. We are gathered here this afternoon to talk through an issue that is reserved to Westminster. We could be talking about the woeful processing times at Social Security Scotland and the impact they have been having on the most vulnerable in Scotland. We could be talking about the tumbling education standards in Scotland that have come as a result of the Scottish Government's failures over the last 16 years. Or we could even be talking about the massive squeeze that local authorities are staring down the barrel of as a result of the SNP and Greens' refusal to allocate appropriate funds. But instead, we are talking about an issue that is not in our portfolio. It is being used as nothing more and an excuse for the SNP and Greens to take cheap shots at the UK government in order to distract from their own disastrous record. And the truth is, Presiding Officer, that this government has failed to protect the most vulnerable in our society at every opportunity. Miles Briggs and others highlighted the importance of local authorities. Yet, as Mr. Briggs pointed out, the Scottish Government have yet again cut their funding, particularly around housing. Donald Cameron, in his usual skillful manner, brought his own personal experience to difficult situations and showed us that actually things were worse under Labour. Many speakers have congratulated the third sector, and I agree and pay tribute to all the work done by the third sector across Scotland in this area. But they need funding, not less, from this government if they are really to reach out. Other speakers, including Alex Cole-Hamilton, seem to argue for a completely open-door policy that will not restrict anyone from coming in for whatever reason. As always, the Scottish Government likes to talk a big game when it comes to its commitment to refugees. But as with everything else, the delivery is left wanting. As other speakers have commented on, look at their commitment to the fleeing the war of Ukraine. The SNP went to great lengths to assure everyone that there would be no limit to the number of refugees that they would welcome. They wanted to contrast themselves with a big bad UK government. And once again, they ran into the hard-nosed reality of life. And a hard dose of reality. Why? Because in July 2022, they paused the scheme. And yet, funny enough, it's still not been recommenced. In addition to this, as of April of this year, over 7,500 Ukrainians were stuck in temporary accommodation in Scotland. The Scottish Government made a promise to them that they would find safe and permanent accommodation here. However, thousands have been stuck in limbo, not known when or if they will get a stable home. Presiding Officer, there can be no doubt that this government is on very shaky ground when it comes to giving lectures on how to care for vulnerable. One only needs to look at the chaos that has been engulfed them as they rolled out devolved benefits for Social Security.
Excuse me, Mr. Balfour, I'm going to take a point of order from Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I just wanted to clarify, Presiding Officer, if Jeremy Balfour could actually see his screen, because I've tried to intervene on him several times, and I don't think he's actually been aware of that. He's certainly not acknowledged it.
OK. That may not be a point of order, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. Your comment is on the record, and I will ask Mr. Balfour to continue. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I apologise to my colleague, and of course, I'm very happy to take his intervention.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Well, I'm very grateful to Jeremy Balfour for giving way, and I am loath to interrupt his speech. It must have sounded great in the shaving room mirror this morning, but it isn't landing as well as I think he suspected in the chamber this afternoon, not least because some of the rhetoric he is using is actually playing to the dog whistle politics of the hard right of the Conservative Party in London. The Liberal Democrats' policy is not an open door, come all ye to our country. It is about safe and legal routes for people who are legitimately seeking safe harbour in these islands because they are fleeing war and persecution. And I think he diminishes himself and the chamber with the rhetoric that he's using.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank the member for his second speech? I actually, just so simply listening to his speech, that is what he said in his speech. Now, that might not be the policy, but that is what came across as I was listening carefully to his contribution this afternoon. Presiding Officer, there can be no doubt that this government, as I said, is on very shaky ground when it comes to giving lectures on how to care for vulnerable. Presiding Officer, we are all in agreement that those who are feeling persecution in their home country should be able to find refuge here. But we must ensure that we have a system that meets two criteria. Firstly, that is a system that is functional and delivers for those in need, ensuring a fine balance between generosity and affordability. And secondly, a system that makes sure that those seeking refuge come through safe and legal routes. Neither of these are optional. There is no workable solution that does not meet these. We cannot follow the same pattern that the Scottish Government has set out over its 16-year tenure of promising the world and delivering an atlas. We need to have grown-up discussion. The fact that the SNP have used this opportunity as a mudslinging exercise to try to promote independence does not bode well. I'm happy to say that I will be supporting the Conservative motion this evening. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I call on Christina McKelvey to wind up. 9 minutes or so, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I think this debate has been an opportunity to recognise the impact that UK Government asylum policy and legislation has here in Scotland on people seeking asylum, local authorities, public services, third sector support organisations and communities. And like Rona Mackay and others, can I thank the Scottish Refugee Council, COSLA and the many, many more organisations who keep us briefed and work every day to support those seeking sanctuary in Scotland. It is important for this Parliament to discuss these matters because of the impact on devolved services and support in place in Scotland. This was recognised by Faisal Chowdhury in his summing up, but sadly not recognised by the UK Government's representatives in this Parliament, the Scottish Conservatives. And as the Scottish Refugee Council briefing says, we recognise asylum is a reserved matter, but people are not.
Point of order, Miles Briggs.
Of the UK Government. We are Scottish Conservative Unionist members on our own.
Thank Mr Briggs for his point of order. Minister, if you'd like to continue.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Scotland has sought to take a different approach to support integration for refugees and people seeking asylum from day one of arrival. And I agree with Maggie Chapman and Karen Adam, we do need many more new Scots. The new Scots Refugee Integration Strategy is a partnership led by the Scottish Government, COSLA and the Scottish Refugee Council. It recognises that we can do more together to support people who have been forced to find a place of safety. And I hope members in this chamber, across this chamber, welcome the support of the Right to Work pilot proposed by my colleague Emma Roddick in her opening remarks. And as CoCab Stewart and Gordon MacDonald said, the Right to Work works effectively in other EU countries that adds to their economic growth. Why wouldn't we want to do the same? I know the Maryhill Integration Network, who has been championed by Bob Doris, and I know that they will welcome this pilot because they have called for it for many, many years. And Bob Doris also asked about the challenges in Glasgow. The Housing Minister is working closely with Glasgow City Council, and I will ask him to ensure that he will respond to Bob Doris in more detail on that issue and others who raised it in the Chamber. We need to be clear that what we are talking about here is people who have applied to the UK Government to have the refugee status recognised or to access humanitarian protection because it is unsafe for them to return to their country of origin. Paul O'Kane asked about the Act implementation and some of the mitigations that we are currently looking at, and I would wish to update him in the fact that this Government continues to work in looking at all available mitigations within our devolved powers. We are doing that as we speak and within the law, and we will also continue to engage with all of those stakeholders. But if there's any positive ideas that Paul O'Kane would wish to add to that, we would be willing to hear them, and we thank him for it. Kevin Stewart.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for giving way. And I recognise that the Scottish Government has put in place a number of things to mitigate the excesses of the UK Government's asylum and refugee policy. But one of the things which has made some of these things much more difficult is the no recourse to public funds legislation that the UK has put in place. Can I ask the Minister how much of an impediment she thinks no recourse to public funds is in terms of helping some of those most vulnerable people?
Minister. Yeah,
thanks very much. Can I thank Kevin Stewart for that very timely intervention? He will know from our past work together on this issue, whether as backbenchers or as members of the Government, that challenging the UK Government on the use of no recourse to public funds has been something that we have continued to do and we will continue to do. And one prime example of that is a woman fleeing domestic violence not allowed to access refuge when she needs it. That's absolutely disgraceful, and that's one prime example of why no recourse to public funds is just not acceptable in any compassionate society. But it's right that there is a process to consider and determine asylum applications, but the UK needs an effective, efficient asylum system that delivers for people who may be highly vulnerable. That asylum system should ensure that the UK upholds the 1951 UN Convention on Refugees. And the experience of Mrs. Ibrahim, you know, told to us today by Paul Sweeney, his testament as to why we need a system that works. And Paul Sweeney had asked in his contribution about getting an update and how we can contribute to that work that he's doing there. The Minister is willing to speak to you on that, so drop her a line and she'll pick that issue up with you in more detail.
Presiding officer, the 1951 Convention does not prescribe a specific mechanism through which states should determine refugee status. According to international law, everyone who satisfies the definition set out in the Convention is a refugee, and signatory states have responsibilities to recognise and protect refugees. It also does not require someone to seek asylum in the first country they come to, a dreadful misrepresentation of asylum law. And as Gordon MacDonald reminded us, the UK does not take anywhere near the numbers of our close European neighbours when it comes to taking in people seeking sanctuary. The UK government asylum policy and legislation is increasingly seeking to undermine the established international refugee protection system. This damages the UK's international reputation and puts people in need of protection at risk. With the Rwanda policy only decides the basis of someone's mode of transport, not their protected characteristic, not their vulnerability, and certainly not the reasons why they would be seeking sanctuary, because there's actually no, apart from some specific programmes, any safe routes currently to the UK. And I would challenge anybody in here to tell me they are, because no one can find them. So pushing back the boats and all the rhetoric about trying to keep people safe, create some safe routes, and then they will be safe and they won't need to go to people traffickers. The focus of this debate is on the impact of UK government asylum policy and legislation in Scotland. The hostile environment and dangerous rhetoric has a direct impact on people living in our communities. And can I also share Colcab Stewart's concerns around about the impact of the legislation that the UK government are proposing and have brought in on trafficking victims? I share her concerns and Tara's concerns in this too. And people seeking asylum are members of our communities who are living with constant uncertainty about when they will receive a decision and what it will say. They are living in contingency hotels and in dispersal accommodation. They are restricted from working and relying on low levels of financial support. £1.25 per day. Health and well-being is particularly challenging for people in these situations, and there's key concerns of people who are in institutional situations. Some members today mentioned the barges in the Bibby Stockholm situation, and we heard just today that Leonard Farouk lay for 12 hours on the Bibby Stockholm dead before anybody realised. That's a disgraceful situation to be in, and it should be nowhere near anything that we want to be recognised for in the UK. For people who are granted asylum and become newly recognised refugees, there are further challenges as the UK government removes support and accommodation after just 28 days. But according to the Scottish Refugee Council, sometimes that's shortened to just 14 days, and in some cases, 7 days. So I was glad to hear Miles Brigg recognise that issue. Hopefully he'll ask his pals at Westminster to fix it. We also know that many people are receiving late notice of this support removal. And for local authorities, raised by Bob Doris, this minimum notice period and increasingly late notification is creating significant pressure as newly recognised refugees present for mainstream housing support. UK government streamlined asylum process is exacerbating this and have not provided any additional funding to support local authorities. And that's before we take into account the needs of unaccompanied children. The UK legislation rides roughshod over our established child protection responsibilities and it treats cases with disbelief. I remember well the situation where the UK government is proposing x-ray in children's wrists to determine age. Please don't let's hear anything like that ever again. People should not be at risk of homelessness and destitution at the point the UK government recognises their need for protection as refugees. This is not a new issue either. We heard from Colcab Stewart, it was raised in the committee that I chaired in 2017. It's something that we've all wanted to have tackled. That report in 2017 created the strategy that we have now, and I'm happy to update Colcab Stewart that the refresh of that strategy will be available in March this year. The UK government asylum policy and legislation will continue to impact on all devolved areas. I encourage you all to agree the debate motion, to recognise that impact and to oppose the Scottish Government's pursuit of its plan. The impact assessment cost for Rwanda was initially £169 million for 1,000 people, a sum of £169,000 per person.
a cost that has now topped £290 million. Imagine what COSLA and organisations in Scotland could do with £169,000 per person. It would transform services and the work that they do to support those people. Presiding Officer, I recognise, and I hope the UK Government, they must recognise the engagement of Scottish local authorities in asylum dispersal, and agree that the UK Government needs to engage positively with devolved governments, local authorities, public services across asylum matters to reduce the negative impact on people coming to our communities. Maggie Chapman, co-cab Stuart and Karen Adam gave us a timely reminder of the dehumanising language, stop the boats. Words such as swarm and invasion has a dreadful impact on those most vulnerable, and that's why we welcome the Together with Refugees campaign. The Together with Refugees campaign has got a set of principles that align with the long-standing Scottish Government positions and Scotland's new Scots refugee integration strategy developed by and delivered in partnership with COSLA and the Refugee Council. I would ask everyone in this chamber to get behind the Refugee Council and the Refugee Together strategy. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the impact of UK Government asylum policy and legislation in Scotland. It's now time to move on to the next item of business. Point of order, Bob Dorris.
Presiding Officer, earlier today, Miles Briggs MSP took exception.
Excuse me.
Been called.
Thank you, Mr Dorris. I was just calling for your microphone.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Earlier today, Miles Briggs MSP took exception to being called a representative of the UK Government. Presiding Officer, I can well understand why. I would also take offence. But in doing so, I think he may have inadvertently misled Parliament. Mr Briggs stated he was a representative of the Scottish Conservative Party. So this afternoon, Presiding Officer, I checked the Electoral Commission website and I can confirm no such party exists. The only party that exists is the Conservative and Unionist Party. Can I ask Presiding Officer how, under standing orders, Mr Briggs can correct this inadvertent misleading of Parliament?
People are not sure that's a point of order. Yes. Thank you, Mr Dorris, for your contribution. I'm sure that at this point in this session, members are very well aware of the mechanism that exists to correct any potential inaccuracies. And I think at this point we will move on to the next item of business. Point of order, Miles Briggs.
I think in the item of clarity, I think maybe Mr Dorris needs to get a life and understand that we're here to represent people in this Parliament.
Yes. I think, of course, we will continue, members, to treat one another with courtesy and respect, and we will move on to the next item of business. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 11821 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and Happy New Year. Moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion, and the question is that motion 11821 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of three Parliamentary Bureau motions, and I ask George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move motions 11822 on approval of an SSI, 11823 on designation of a lead committee, and 11824 on committee meeting time.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and all three moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time, and I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Happy to be helpful, as always, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, and there are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. And the first is that Amendment 11803.1 in the name of Miles Briggs, which seeks to amend Motion 11803 in the name of Emma Roddick on the impact of UK Government asylum policy and legislation in Scotland, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. Therefore, we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting.